I walk in the door, there is Ms. Dent smiling. Everybody's happy. They are happy to be there to teach our children. This is important, and I really don't believe that if we put them in a city setting, they're going to get that care. It's not going to happen because it's going to be too overcrowded. The teacher's going to be too overwhelmed. And I really don't think it's fair that we should have to put that burden on them when they're already in a decent environment. They're in an environment where they're learning, they're laughing, they're playing, they're happy. Why fix something if it's not broken? It's not broken. Everything is all right. Let's focus on some of the other things in our community that needs to be fixed. In our community, our children are safe. We know that we can go forward and do other things because we know that our kids are all right. They don't have this situation shouldn't even be. It's a waste of time. It really is. Truthfully and honestly speaking, it's a waste of time, energy, and money. If we put them in a city setting, you're going to be open to lawsuits. These are little kids. They can be hurt. The bigger kids are going to trample over them. Come on. They're going to be trampled over. They're too little. They can't really defend themselves. I have another grandson in a city setting. Every other day, he's having an issue. I don't want to see my little granddaughter getting beat up because she can't defend herself. She's a little girl. She should be around little kids where they understand each other. They got their own little language going. They play, they laugh, they do what they need to do. Right now, honestly, I'm so nervous, but I have to say, I really have to say, pick on somebody your own size.
Hello, good afternoon. My name is Shandora Quinones. My daughter attends Audrey Johnson Daycare Center. My husband and I rely on Audrey Johnson Daycare Center to provide quality service for my child. It is more than just quality service for us. It's a support system for us because that's what we have to depend on to make sure our child is safe. When I go out to work, I need to know that my child is in an environment where she's going to learn and where she is going to be safe. And I don't want no one, when they talk about my child, to refer to my child as getting a slot. I don't need a slot for my child. I need quality care. And this decision is very ignorant. And I think ignorance is far more expensive than quality care.
Good afternoon. My name is Adetola Adedoko. My son attends Lucy Rose Daycare Center in Far Rockaway. The way I say the whole thing is like a gambling table. It's like they're having the higher hands. And you are the one that can convince them because their hearts are so hardened. Our kids, like my son, I'm 38 years old. It takes me time to have my son. The daycare center my son is going to, I have a rest of mind my son is going there. Because they really take good care of the kids, and it's like I'm leaving my child for another mother that is so caring. The city school, the public school is so crowded. I don't think those people that just left, they have any child in any of the daycare center. I don't think they ever been in the public school and see the way it's so crowded. They're not in our shoes. The crisis that is going on in the New York City is not we low class that have to suffer it. It's not our kids that have to go through the economic crisis. Please, I don't know where you can go or how you can please appeal to them to look for somewhere else, maybe parking meters, tolls, to look for where to close their budget. Is not where, I mean, our future, this is the future of New York City. And I don't think the poor have to be getting poorer or the rich have to be getting richer. This equal life and equal opportunity in New York City. Thank you.
All right. Thank you very much. Let's thank the children. That's really... Oh, we have one more mom here. Oh, okay. Anybody can... Okay, we make it really fast.
Yes. Okay. Estoy representando a Audrey Johnson. Mi hija está aquí presente. Es una situación...
She's representing Audrey Johnson because her daughter is right here.
Es una situación muy difícil para nosotros los padres que tenemos negocios propios.
It's a very difficult situation for parents who, like her, have a business of her own.
Mi esposo y yo tenemos bodega. Trabajamos de 8 de la mañana a 7, 8 de la noche.
Her and her husband have a bodega and they work from early in the morning until 7 and 8 at night.
Si cierran los kindergarten de los daycare, no podemos recoger los niños a las 2:30 porque trabajamos todo el día y yo no tengo, personalmente nosotros, no tenemos quien nos recoja los niños.
If I have to pick up my child at 2:30, it's completely impossible. We will not be able to survive. I cannot do that. My husband and I don't have anyone else to help us.
La calidad de la escuela no es la misma que en el daycare porque nos vamos tranquilos sabiendo que están bien cuidados, que están limpios, que están bien, que comen a su hora y que todo está en su momento. Es una situación...
Sorry. Me and my husband, we are confident that the children are well taken care of in the daycare center. She trusts the daycare center. She knows the people. They know they eat on time. They know the place is clean.
Necesitamos esta educación para nuestros hijos para poder trabajar tranquilos.
In order to work in peace, they need this service.
Como dice con todo respeto nuestro alcalde en un anuncio de TV.
How Bloomberg says in one of his TV ads.
Nueva York es de todos.
New York belongs to everyone.
Y lo hacemos entre todos.
And we do it together.
Esta no es la mejor decisión porque nos está afectando a todos.
It's not a good decision, it's affecting everyone.
Y en este momento necesitamos su apoyo.
And in this moment they really need the support from the mayor.
Thank you, Aurora speaks.
Thank you, muchas gracias, señora. We've heard from the UFT. I would like to hear from 1707 and from CSA. So, GL, are you ready? You're going to... If you can speak loud enough, yes, right there. And then Dr. Randy Herman from CSA. Oh, this is the team here.
Yes, ma'am.
Oh, you're like the city. They have a team. Team Save Daycare.
Good afternoon. I want to thank the chairs of the Senate and Assembly Committees on Children and Families and the New York State Senate Assembly Committees on Education for their compassionate concern on the welfare on the state's real future as children. I am speaking on behalf of DC 1707 Executive Director Raglan George, who is under the weather, and sends his best wishes to the Joint Committee. My name is G.L. Tyler. I have been Political Action Director for District Council 1707 for more than 13 years. And in that time, I have never witnessed the sustained assault on New York City's public child care system as I have witnessed under the mayoral administration of Michael Bloomberg. For the past 8 years, the city, through backward and ham-handed methods of ACS, have attempted both full-scale frontal assaults on the system to attempting to dismantle the system brick by brick under the disguise of progress and efficiency, and neither applies. While progressive nations around the globe are advancing public center-based child care for the benefit of social and economic advancement, this mayor is deploying disruptible schemes to send back child care to the 50s when it did not exist in this country. In this national time of change for working families, ACS Commissioner Manley has stated that daycare should be competitive. This is a code word for working families must pay more for child care to private, for-profit options. New York City has been the model, the vanguard of public child care in the nation. Only the U.S. military has comparable options. I am speaking for the nearly 6,000 members of daycare employees 205 and the nearly 2,000 employees of Head Start employees Local 95. Both of these locals will lose members if the city's incredulous plans to shut down kindergarten classes and universal pre-K and daycares and for Head Start a retroactive 3.3% budget cut from February 2009 taking effect May 26, 2009. If the city of New York cannot place kindergarten classes and UPK in public schools because the capacity is not there, then why take these classes from public daycare centers and Head Start? It is the position of the district council that the options that Mayor Bloomberg and ACS provide are fiscally irresponsible and practically union busting. The city is willing to spend more money on placing children in public schools, perhaps up to $7 million, according to the Daily News, then keep kindergarten and UPK instead of both base daycare. In addition, the transfer of kindergarten to public schools will result in millions more spent on busing and legally mandated building modifications for the children, which ACS did not speak about. The city has not demonstrated concern on the impact of closing daycare classrooms will have on married and single parents whose lives will be torn if the city is allowed to close these classrooms. Children and working parents need safe, affordable, and quality child care. Parents do not need additional anxiety finding competent care for their children. But only sustained political and community action has forced ACS to stop their plans in the past. Your committees can build the necessary political pressure and find competent solutions to these issues. Two solutions I heard before is one, the possibility of a moratorium. Then secondly, we do need more money for public child care in New York City. Children are not an unprotected class. There are many laws which regulate how adults and institutions should treat and educate children, but guarantees and protections are limited when certain services for children are indicated. Public education is guaranteed, public center-based child care is not. Children under the age of 6 years old do not have personal protections related to public child care. New York City has been fortunate that a moderate Republican, Mayor John Lindsay, some years ago pressed to have public center-based child care in the five boroughs. Now a George Bush Republican, Michael Bloomberg, has a different agenda. Now 3,300 five-year-olds are at risk of not having full-time care this September. The city's faulty enrollment system is leaving centers unenrolled as well. And the ACS much-heralded Project Full Employment will fail its task, leaving many centers not able to meet their budgets, causing classrooms to close and staff unemployed. The union is seeking a measure of relief from the Joint Committee. We have talking points that we distributed that provide remedies to some of these issues. Look at the facts. The Joint Committee must find a way to keep classrooms open and more children in care with efficiency and wisdom. And above all, if the system is effective, keep it and let it grow. Thank you.
I'm here representing over 25,000 members who work in social service, daycare, Head Start, home care, direct care workers. So this budget is attacking all our fields. 1707 is the community-based union. We are the one that holds families together. It's amazing how ACS sat up here and said they do all these wonderful things for children and yet they attack our communities. They say they protect children. They love children, but yet they want to close our daycare and Head Starts. They haven't fixed foster care. Let's take a look at the basic cause of these situations here. If they haven't gotten foster care right, what makes sure that they can fix a situation that's already perfect, that's already right? The whole world looks at New York City's child care.
Our Head Start programs were the model for the country and for the world. Our daycare centers were the same thing and are the same thing. As you've heard parents testify and teachers testify and directors testify, they are all certified teachers and assistant teachers. They follow the mandates and they go for extra programming. They talk about families staying home. They talk about the foster care system, how they're fixing it. Head Start prevents those issues. They help heal the family. Disenfranchised youth, our children. For some of our children, it's three hot meals a day that they receive, and care and protection. Their parents are educated, they receive GEDs. Many of the parents, as Annette Robinson can tell you, who was a former worker in Head Start program, have gone on to college and been productive. Our daycare centers do the same thing. They become social workers, they're caregivers. I know when my daughter was young, I had her in daycare. It was a daycare teacher who told me she has ADHD. Be careful. Don't allow them to give her meds. Work on it holistically. ACS here today sat along with the Department of Education, who make me laugh, who set back over $50 million in the last 2 years for education that could have gone into the daycare and Head Start programs. They sent it back. But yet they sit here and say, maybe shoulda, coulda, woulda, I don't know, in the midst of. No one has a concrete answer. No one has a concrete number. Shame on them. Children come first. They don't come first. They can probably fix the deficit by getting rid of half of the commissioners they have employed. Let's take a look at it. If I look at half of the commissioners that sat at this table alone, in just base salary at 75 grand to 100 grand a year, plus their perks, has probably filled the deficit gap that can go into the daycare centers to keep them enrolled. Daycare centers and Head Start centers are a valuable part of the community. They help the community stay alive and be sustained, not only giving parents a safe place to put their children, but just like the mother said, she owned a bodega with her husband. The small store owners are able to keep their stores open. Why? Because the staff goes in there to buy a soda, or they get something to drink, or they live in the community themselves. The banks are able to open. We keep them working. We keep them healthy. In the Highbridge section of the Bronx, which we call the Roberto Clemente area, because I'm a Bronx girl, straight out of the heart of the Bronx, 200 children lost their slot because ACS said they had a leaky roof. 200 children, which means 200 parents. If it's one mother, loses a job. If it's both parents, one loses a job. And in the Bronx, there's barely an affordable rent anymore. For us, an affordable rent is $800 for a two-bedroom apartment, when the going rate now is $1,500 or better. Not only did it house 200 children, it housed over 100 workers who helped the community thrive, who lived in the community, walked to work in the community. Now these parents have to scramble within a 15-block radius to find a program to put their child in and be on a waiting list. ACS talked about 3,300 children that they're going to have maybe a spot for, but they're not talking about the children who have been on a waiting list for a year and a half just to get into the Board of Ed for kindergarten. So now we have to compound those numbers, brothers and sisters. So we're not looking at 3,300 children. We're looking at 6,000 children. Okay? Let's look at those numbers. Let's be real. Maybe my numbers may be inflated, but you know what? It made everyone in this room pay attention to it. We need the daycares open. We need the Head Starts open. We need people to work. They talk about welfare. That was a shame. That's an abomination. We keep the parents working. We don't have to worry about the system crumbling. If the president of our country was a Head Start child himself and is pushing Head Start in daycare, then we need to wake up, brothers and sisters, and take a look at what works. If, like the sister said, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. We should be ashamed that we allow people that we put in commissioner seats to tell us what it's like, because they became so far removed they forgot where they came from. Commissioner Mattingly, who is the commissioner of all ACS, should have had himself sitting right in this room to make sure that his point was brought across and heard what we have to say. But instead, he sent his staff that once the water started to rise on the boat, they ran like rats out of the room. Now, why don't they have the answers? A million questions were given by the panel. A million questions from the audience were given. Transportation costs, yellow school buses, matrons on the buses, insurance for child that sit on there. The parents who have to rush now and leave a job, like the brother said, I've got to leave work to go pick up my son early just so that I can make sure they have care. But now you've got after schools that are closing by the DOE, who have no, I know because in Co-op City alone, two of the after schools have closed and that were free. Now the parents have to scramble to find after schools that they have to pay for that, even though we say Co-op City may be affluent, but not anymore. Both parents have to work in order to maintain the living and quality that they have. We have to look at this. It's not fair. But I tell you what, they need to start from the top down and not from the bottom up, because we're what makes this city great. This is what makes our place of our country what it is today. Without the working class, there is New York, no New York City. And yes, there's two other points. It's union busting at its best, and it's a subliminal, seductive gentrification of our city. Push us out, they push the wealthy in. But without us, the wealthy can't get any richer, neither can Michael Bloomberg. They need us as much as we need them. But if 1707 went out on strike, the city would fail to move. Fire department would have no place to put their children. The police department would have no place to put their children. The Board of Education teachers would have no place to put their children. City workers would have no place to put their children, and state workers would have no place to put their children. The median salary in 1707 amongst our members is anywhere from $20,000 to $30,000 a year. The staffers who staff these daycares are the same people who put their children in the daycare centers and Head Start programs. They're graduates from those programs. So yes, it's a feeding wheel. Michael Bloomberg needs to be ashamed for every advertisement he puts out there and says he cares about children, because he really doesn't. Why? Because our children don't look like him? That's another question we need to ask. That ends my testimony for today. I hope you heard us loud and clear, and I thank you for allowing me to be here.
Thank you. VP Herman?
I was going to start with good morning, but it seems to be good afternoon.
It's afternoon.
Members of the Senate and the Assembly, thank you for offering us this public forum for my members, the directors of the city-funded daycare centers, and for the parents who trust them with their most precious gift, their children. This would be the only public forum that they would have for these discussions, other than testimony before the City Council. We've brought the issue before them, they have discussed it at length, and yet here we are already at the state level. It has gotten to that point, but we are all grateful that you also think it's important enough to warrant these hearings. I have to commend my members, the daycare directors, for getting their parents here to speak with you so that you will hear their stories and their concerns. What we bring to you is what we know the issues to be. For them, it's really personal. The unions are here today. You've heard from the UFT, 1707, now CSA, because we know that what's good for the children is good for the parents, what's good for the parents is good for our members, and what's good for everyone is good for New York. And we all want this city to be a place that's kid-friendly, that we want to live in, where we can raise our children. And for us as union members, if this was just about a paycheck or collective bargaining, we would always be underpaid.
That's right.
It would never catch up. But what we get from the services that we can provide is more than what we could ever hope to get back monetarily. You've all heard, and I think we all agree here, that kids don't get a second chance at a good beginning. We've all heard that one. We've all heard invest in child care. We've all heard about the fact that for every dollar that's spent on early care and education, you save seven. There is no dispute about those facts. So, why is it that we're in a position of trying to defend cuts to early care and education? Our president clearly thinks it's valuable. Why doesn't New York City think it's valuable? Well, it does say something about our character as a society that we're even contemplating an action like this. But we're going to make a very clear distinction here that it's not about the value of early care and education. It's about a mayoral agency balancing their budget. And we really need just to focus on that. So let's look just at the numbers to balance the budget. I was a former budget person. All right, now let's say everything goes the way they say it's going to go and everybody gets a seat and everybody has after school care. Let's look at the cost. Now, this is an average because I don't have exact numbers. Nobody wants to disclose them. But on the average, a kindergarten class in city-funded daycare of 18 to 20 kids with a teacher, an assistant teacher, and an aide, operating for that full 10 to 12 hour day, 300 and something days a year, is about $90,000. Shift that to New York City Department of Education, which operates instructional programs about 180 days out of the year, a shorter school day, and as you heard from Ms. Cabrera, maximum class size could be as high as 25. Average cost there, a teacher and maybe a para in the room, standard instructional day, you're looking at 100,000 plus. That doesn't include the transportation. That's not including the after-school program. That's not including anything but the standard day. And as you heard, if you go above the number of children that you currently have projected on register, you heard from the UFT, it is impossible not to give the school additional funding to support those children. That's fair student funding. A unit of fair student funding for a kindergarten child is approximately $4,000. So multiply it out. That's where I got the $100,000 from. That's what I know. Now, city-funded daycare clearly is the better bargain. So it's very clear to me that it's a monetary issue. Now, there are some things that ACS does very, very well. Child Protection Services is one of those things. Foster care, as you heard, they're still trying to get right, but they're making headway. Maybe this isn't one of the things that they should be doing. That's something we need to talk about and consider moving forward. For right now, you've brought up the idea of a moratorium. It's a very sound idea. The decision to move forward with this kindergarten transition was made unilaterally, without consultation. They looked at it as a budgetary move. We're looking at it as something else. We're looking at it from an educational standpoint. We're looking at it from the standpoint of the members of the community for whom that daycare center is an intricate part of the fabric of the community. So I'd like to take a step backward, if you would, to something that worked and worked well. And you've heard daycare works well. In the past, it has happened that the Department of Education received the money for kindergarten. And they had contracts with the community-based organizations. I think everybody here remembers that. It worked well for the community-based organizations, and it worked well for the Department of Education. What you didn't hear today was that ACS has said there will be no more contracts with the Department of Education. You will only contract with ACS for kindergarten. If somehow we can allow the CBOs to contract again through the RFP process with the Department of Education, and those kindergarten dollars funnel through the DOE, and ACS is out of the picture, well, they don't have these budgetary woes, do they? So that's a proposal we'd like to make going forward. Children stay where they are. Families aren't upset. Communities aren't upset. Kids aren't upset. And the process continues as is until such time as there's some thoughtful discussion about creating a new infrastructure for city-funded daycare that meets the needs of the city in 2009, 2010, 2020, and 2040. Thank you for your attention.
I wanted to just, that's the kind of proposal and idea that we're looking for. And my colleague here and I have agreed that we're going to be meeting shortly after this hearing to talk about what can we do, because if we have some time, we want the idea of the moratorium, we need more time. Clearly there's no plan. It was not done thoughtfully or carefully or with the interest and care of children and families in mind. So, but we, if we have an opportunity and some time, I think that with you, your input, some of our ideas, we can come up with a new, I think someone else said it, a new paradigm for how we fund childcare in our state and in the city. So that's
I absolutely agree with my colleague, and I think we have some wonderful ideas here. In terms of getting the time that we need, because these people have clearly shown themselves to be prepared to move forward unilaterally and run roughshod, and so I'm wondering if any of the unions or any of the affected parents have thought out what remedies might be available to you as parties who have been or being impacted by this plan, and whether you've looked at any remedies that might be available to get more input, let us say, into the situation.
You mean in terms of asking for meetings with the commissioner, the deputy commissioner, to discuss this? Yeah, we've tried. In fact, the proposal we just made was made sitting across the table from the commissioner. About the same response you got here this morning.
Well, I'm firmly of the opinion that we should be looking at any and all possible steps and remedies.
Well, none were entertained, but several were proposed.
Thank you, Ms. Herman. Thank all of you for being here and being so concerned about what happens. Can you hear me? Being so concerned about what happens to our children. We're here for the same reason. I'm just trying to keep them freezing to death in this place. but the question that I have for you is, we're not nearly meeting the needs in the city for daycare slots. That's mm-hmm. the reality. We don't have the space in our school buildings, as many of you have said, for all of the kindergarten children. Mm-hmm. But we really have to think clearly and deeply about this. Because we're not meeting our daycare slots, there are things that can be created where we can accommodate children. I've fought in Albany for years and years and years about for additional daycare slots. And the folks up there and the folks down here who were supposed to know how many we needed didn't know. All right? I can remember getting millions of dollars in the budget to try to start to build new daycare centers, not repair these old storefronts in this city. And only $50,000 of that money went to the city because people didn't come forward to get it. We have a serious, serious issue that we're going to have to look at more than just when we have a crisis with this thing. The State Board of Regents has said that all kindergarten kids are going to have to be in school. The division of student academic development or whatever. At some point, I can't remember the exact year. I thought it was 2010. It may be later. So, but it's clear, having listened to this, this hasn't thought out. It hasn't been thought out, as everybody said, and it's not going to work. But when we, as we deal with this issue, you know, there's enough work and enough need to go around for dealing with four-year-olds and down if we do it right. If we do it right, that's the issue that I'm trying to push here. I'm in agreement with my colleagues that we need to do something about what's going on now because it's obviously not together. But as we go forward, I think we're going to have to really think about the realities of what we're dealing with in this children thing, and I think we can do more together to make sure things are done the way they're supposed to be done and they also be properly funded. Because I don't think the daycare centers are getting near what they should be getting. I don't think they need are getting near what they should be getting paid. Yes, teachers have to be certified, but they don't stay. Because they, when they get into the New York City Department of Education, they go there because they get paid more money. Let's be real.
Nearly
so,
double.
So that's those are the issues that we have to really get down and dirty and deal with. This thing is a real comprehensive piece. But I can assure you, if we get the data, we're not meeting probably half the need for daycare that we have to do. I had to turn my office almost into a daycare center when my daughter had to go back to work after 6 months with her little girl. She was with me at every ribbon cutting I was at because there was no place I could get we could get her into until she was 2 years old. You know, my bill that put in the money said you had to be, they had to build these daycare centers for from 0 to 5 years old.
Mm-hmm.
All right, because there was no places that were keeping kids under 2 years old that hadn't been potty trained. Now that goes back a few years now, and maybe that's not the case anymore. But we have a lot of work to do that we need to do together. So thank you all very much for listening to me. Now I wasn't supposed to testify.
Thank you. You know, first, thanks for your testimony. And I think there's one thing, though, that's clear, because it's clear that ACS and DOE don't have a plan in place that will allow them to implement this grander idea. Because I don't think that's what's motivating them. It's not really about money, because they're not going to save any money. In fact, it's probably going to cost them additional money. They've admitted that they don't have sufficient seats in kindergartens in the public schools. They've admitted that we have a shortage of daycare. They've made all this, the plan doesn't seem to make any sense. But there is one thing that is fairly consistent with this administration, and I think both G.L. Tyler and you hit on it. You know, union busting is a pretty, you know, inflammatory term, and it's not like I haven't thrown it around from time to time in my career. But what I'm seeing with this administration is, and particularly when I say this administration, not just the mayor, this agency, ACS, and Commissioner Mattingly, and you're right, he should have been here today. It's a critically important issue, but he tends not to come to controversial meetings because I think he's tired of us yelling at him. But he's been making decisions for the past several years now that are really ideological as opposed to budgetary. Whether it was the decision to close the agency-run group homes that service the most difficult-to-place adolescents who were serviced by the former Child Welfare Administration, transferring it to the private sector, whether the mayor in his budget this year deciding to close the after-school programs in the NYCHA developments, not because of money, because they sought to replace them with a contracted program, throwing thousands of parents into, you know, disarray right before the holidays with no after-school programs for their children. What now, this program doesn't seem to make any sense, but clearly what they get to accomplish is they ship the responsibility of kindergarten to another agency, and then they have the justification to begin to downsize publicly subsidized daycare. That is a very clear plan on the part of this administration. And I think that's something that we in the legislature really need to take a look at, it because it's happening across every aspect of the service provision that ACS has, any role that ACS has in communities. And I think that Senator Montgomery, you and I are going to work very closely on this. This is an ideological bent with this agency. And finally, your suggestion about maybe ACS transferring over responsibility for kindergarten daycare, perhaps to DOE through and doing it through the community-based organizations. I remember when ACS was created, they did not want anything to do with the Agency for Child Development. In fact, they were forced to accept them and the Office of Child Support Enforcement as a condition of the creation of that mayoral agency. So maybe that's an avenue we should go down. Since they never wanted to run the Agency for Child Development, maybe we ought to take it away from them and give it to an agency that actually is interested.
Thank you, and we certainly look forward to continuing this dialogue. Hopefully you will come back with even more ideas and suggestions, proposals, which we all will be looking forward to working on with you.
If I may quickly, yeah, Senator, one suggestion that's in legislation now is Senate Bill 3601 and Assembly Bill 3065, which will require New York City to give 1 year's notice to any closing of any public daycare center.
Right.
It's currently in codes in the Senate, and it should be moved hopefully quicker in the Assembly, but that's one of the things that we could use to assist us right now.
Excellent, and we will track that Monday. We'll start making sure to push that out. Yeah. Yes, we just moved it out of our committee, but it's in codes, so we have to push it out of there. That's where it is now. Exactly. He's a friend.
Okay.
Can I just ask the next four people to also come up? I think this is a good way of dealing with the testimony in blocks. Okay, before you leave, just say something of encouragement to our people. I know. My colleagues have to leave, but I'll be here. Oh, my goodness. We're all so busy. Inez, come down because you're sitting too far from me. And I want to. Child Care Inc., Betty Holcomb, if you would. Policy Analyst, UNH. Greg Bender. Citizens Committee for Children. Stephanie Jendel, the Assistant Executive Director. Is Sandy Sokolar here? I didn't see Sandy. No, we didn't see Sandy. And Black Child Development Institute. And while these are policy organizations, and I just wanted to put them together so this way we have a flow of ideas and thoughts here. Sandy Sokolar is the co-chair of Economic Justice and Social Welfare Network. She's not here, but she is such a wonderful longtime advocate and friend. Where's Carol Brown? Is Carol Brown here? No. Did she leave? We're almost catching up. Stephanie is not here. Oh, okay.
Isn't she here?
She's here like a minute ago.
All right. So we'll go ahead, and if she comes in, she can join us at the table.
Am I on a mic? Because I have a low voice.
Yes, you are.
Yeah? I don't know. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Okay, because I know my voice doesn't always carry.
Could you? Yeah.
I'm sorry, but I have to leave. I have to go to another meeting. I do want to thank both chairs. and my colleagues for holding this committee, and of course everyone who's been here to testify. I will take your testimony with me. It's obvious that we are anxious to come to some sort of a solution that makes sense for the parents, that makes sense for the children, that makes sense for the education system, that makes sense for the workers, and we plan on working very closely with all of you who are interested in this to come up with a sensible solution to a problem that
And I want to thank Senator Savino in particular because she brings her skill and toughness as a former labor union person into the government political arena. And a survivor of ACS. And I really, really appreciate her leadership and her forcefulness. And you can be assured that by her being here, is an indication that she is ready to fight. So I appreciate that, Diane. Thanks a lot. I'm sorry. Okay.
You have my written testimony, and I don't want to bore you by just reading it out loud. I do want to add to things that were said this morning. And I want to start by really honoring what Karen Daughtry said this morning about where we are now, and that this has been a long struggle that I know you have been involved in, and I had hoped to say that to the other folks here. And we appreciate that you're holding this hearing. We also appreciate that there have already been some steps taken at the state level to mitigate these cuts. We know that the stimulus money might not have been there to preserve those 93 classrooms, and that the market rate might not have been paid if there wasn't a lot of attention to this. And we also appreciate the movement on child support regulations, which we hope will be removed soon, and we appreciate your leadership on that. I also wanted to say that Child Care Inc., as a co-convener of Winning Beginning New York, has been working very diligently on looking for ways to keep pre-K expanding and to do it well. And we're working right now on a major new policy paper, sort of looking forward in the terms that you were talking about, in terms of what should it look like for the next decade. We clearly have reached the end of the road in terms of what we can do with 2.5 hours of underfunded services. And so we will be approaching you with that. We also want to alert you to the possibility and hope that you will join in the advocacy that we're doing in the city and the state and nationally around the use of Title I education money for early childhood services. The city is already using about $20 million of Title I funding to expand and supplement and improve pre-K. And we know that there was a point in negotiations over the federal stimulus package where the Senate was going to earmark 15% of Title I for early childhood. And we know that the Obama administration is committed to enhancing, improving, and better resourcing early childhood, as evidenced in the stimulus package. But we think the Title I funding is a particularly important opportunity, and we hope that you'll join us. We're meeting with our federal delegations, too, to really send this message out that some of that Title I money should be used to support early childhood education and services. That money is specifically for closing the achievement gap for children and can be used starting at birth. And so we know that it's been used for pre-K around our state, even though people don't talk about it a lot. School districts have done that. On Long Island, some school districts have used it to support home visiting. And we would like to encourage and work both at the federal and the state level to give guidance to school districts and to allocate some of that money. Because we know the earlier we start, the better return we get on the investment that we make. And we've done a lot of research on that as well that we can share with you all, and would love for you to be an active voice on that. And the other thing, in terms of looking ahead to the 21st century, you know, what should pre-K look like now? We are very much embracing the Regent's policy statement on early childhood education, which says that we ought to start at birth, and that we ought to have full day services for all 3 and 4 year olds, and that we ought to have mandatory kindergarten. And however we do it, however it all works together, who's providing those services, we think it's a huge issue. But we support the Regent's vision, and when we deliver our white paper on UPK, we will basically be giving the roadmap to the ways that we think we can move ahead with that. And in starting my statement with talking about the crisis that we're in, the other thing I want to say is it's been quite moving for me to be in the room this morning, and I've been hearing this, as you're getting an earful now, from people around the city for a while, but I talked personally with some of the directors who are talking about the kind of cuts they're going to have to make because of what the city is calling cost allocation in the 4-year-old classrooms. This comes back to our vision of early childhood and what people have referenced in terms of essentially supplanting child care money. Child Care Inc. worked really hard from the get-go in 1998 to implement UPK as an enhancement. And the Department of Education has embraced the use of that money, bless you, to supplement and enhance programs. And programs around the city use that to build higher quality program models, to add social workers, to add family workers, and even sometimes when they could squeak it out, to pay teachers better, which we all know is the core issue. And what's happening now under, starting 2 years ago, and I don't know what leverage there is at the state level, but the city got special permission to transfer UPK money to ACS starting 2 years ago. And that's when this new scheme started of pulling child care money out when the UPK money came in. And so I just want to, I know, and I was listening with such feeling this morning to people talking about the struggle to build our contracted center of child care and to put different forms of funding together to be able to get to a point where you might be able to pay teachers enough to live on, and you might be able to provide a few benefits. And we know how the unions have struggled and how people have struggled to create this contracted system, essentially a preschool education that other cities don't have. And when the UPK came in, one of the reasons we were very excited is that this could be an engine of positive change, that you could add the resources, you could enhance programs, you could pay teachers, maybe. You could begin to get certified teachers instead of having everybody in a study plan. That was beginning to happen in a lot of programs who put together Head Start, Child Care, Pre-K, Special Ed, and now it's being pulled apart. And I know that ACS is on the firing line in this scheme, but I'm thinking that at the state level, maybe there could be some initiatives and leadership around talking about blending funding that you can't supplant when you bring in money. On this MOU that State Ed agreed to, what are the terms of it? How is ACS going to monitor quality? Coming up on July 1st, NOS ACS program will have a separate contract with DOE. So those are all core issues that we believe you could impact on and have something where there's some leverage that you could talk about, how the funding is being used. In my testimony, I talk about the various issues. I think lots of them have been covered, and we've used words like coordination and the need for, we haven't used the word leadership so much, but I feel that's what's lacking. And when I say ACS is on the firing line, I think that's because we've lacked leadership at the city level and at the state level to really say how agencies work together, how we put this money together to create quality. ACS is taking the brunt of these cuts as an agency, but it's because they're under-resourced and we don't have coordination. We don't have people saying, how are you supposed to run these programs? Programs on the ground are getting visits from ACS, DOE, Head Start. And we think with these cuts, for the first time, programs will be at risk of not being able to meet regulatory standards. I mean, I talked to someone in the back of the room this morning who explained to me they're laying off an assistant director and three aides and a teacher because of the so-called cost allocation. And so we're seeing individual programs at risk, the entire system at risk, and we think that what you're doing today can help spur leadership, accountability, and hopefully the search for new resources. We think that the state should be investing more. I know other people have said it. We know in this climate that there aren't a lot of resources. We appreciate that. And just one last closing thought in terms of the impact. When I say leadership, it's not just on resources and money, but it's also on capacity across systems. The plan that ACS has put on the table and DOE is going along with could end up with empty classrooms in ACS centers that we need very badly, that will still be paid for, in some cases, by city leases, right across the street from overcrowded public schools. We know that this is going on in the Bronx already. There are kindergartners right now, before they started this plan, who are being bused out of their zone school districts to other kindergartners. We know that OST does not have the capacity to serve more children, and we doubt that it has capacity in terms of qualified professionals to deal with the youngest children that this plan is going to put in there, because these are the younger elementary kids. So we're saying we're going to leave them on the street after school in a neighborhood where they don't leave, and then they're trying to find a slot in an after-school program that may not be in their neighborhood, may not be at their school, and may not have capacity. So these plans, just to summarize, bring up these problems that we would like to address with you in terms of planning, about leadership, about coordination of resources, that we bring the eight agencies that oversee the programs in the city together, and we talk about how the $1.2 billion investment in early care and education, that's child care, TANF, Head Start, and UPK, $1.2 billion in the city, that we see ourselves as a single city, that we care about all the children, and that we make all those policies and funding work together. That's what we're aiming for. And I think my testimony addresses the issues about the plan.
The issues that you're raising are really, I think, extremely critical to this process, or to a process that we would like to see.
Right.
And that is the blending of those funds. But I think, you know, looking at what I've seen in the short time that I've been chair, is that very often the way that we create the funding programs, funding for the programs, it is a complete contradiction to ultimately what we intend for them to how we intend for them to be served. So we need to create a process. What we've done with our committees is that I have a cabinet of people who are the frontline providers and advocates that I communicate with on an ongoing basis, because I would like for the issues that they have to be brought to me so that I can address whatever funding or program or whatever the concerns and issues are from their perspective. Hopefully, that so that it works when we do something. And we have to change, perhaps. We will end up with some changes to this system, to the child care system, that will better serve the needs of families and children right now, this and this generation, and perhaps that generation going forward. But we can't do that without your input and your participation. So well, I welcome what you're talking about. We would like to be able to do that. We just need experts like yourselves at this table, and the union, and directors and parents to help us fashion what the new paradigm is going to be.